You're watching Electrical Engineering Lectures channel. For more videos, please do like, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for the latest notifications.
So let us call it capital T, and here it is 2T, here it is 3T. So let's say I have the transmitted bits as 1, 0, and 1. Let us take 3 bits and represent in the form of a rectangular pulse. Simply 1, 0, and 1. Now, as far as this particular equation is concerned, the result of this equation will be what? When AI is equal to 1, it means we will be transmitting the carrier, the same carrier, like this. And when it is 0, we will be transmitting nothing. Similarly, when it is 1, we will be transmitting the carrier. And when it is 0, we will be transmitting nothing. So, due to this reason, that whenever the transmitted bit is 1, and the amplitude definitely will be E2 square root. So either we will be transmitting a carrier with amplitude E2 square root, or we will be transmitting nothing. So it is functioning in the form of a switch, that if the incoming bit is 1, the switch is on. If the incoming bit is 0, the switch is off. So due to this reason, binding ASK is also termed as on-off keying. Or OOK. It is called on-off keying. And in the form of a constellation diagram, because whenever we are studying the modulation schemes, it is very important to study the concept of constellation diagram. Constellation diagram is basically a representation of the symbols in the form of dots having the amplitudes equal to the amplitude of the carrier. So by having a look at the constellation diagram, we will be directly viewing the viewing and comparing different modulation schemes to compare their energies, to compare their performance. So it is simply the representation of the transmitted symbols in the complex plane, right? So here for OOK, simply we can represent, because we do not have any quadrature part, so we will be able to represent the constellation diagram along the x-axis only. So either we are having the point which is 0, or we have a second point which is having the energy E2 square root. So either it is 0 or it is E2, and in the form of bits it is 0 and it is 1, right? So this is the constellation diagram of binding ASK. Okay. Now we discuss the concept of M array pulse amplitude modulation, and then we will discuss the process of demodulation and detection. As I have told you, that the generalized framework of the representation of transmit pulse in the form of basis function will remain the same. So here you can see that Si of t is represented by using the same equation here, Ai into psi 1 of t. But here, because I is from 1 to capital M, and for let's say we consider the case for M is equal to 4. So for M is equal to 4, we will have 4 different values of Ai. Right, and if you generalize this concept, basis function will remain the same, only the values of AI will change to change the linear combination and to generate 4 pulses as compared to the binding case where we have got only 2 pulses. So here the basis function will remain the same, only the values of AI will change, and those values of AI, generally speaking, they can be written as this particular equation. So it is irrespective of the value of M. You can choose any value of M and calculate the values of AI by using this particular equation. Now, in order to generate the constellation diagram as shown in this slide, let me go to the notes and I will tell you how to compute these values of AI, because these are basically the values of AI. If you go into the binding case, this was A1 and this was A2. Now we will have A1, A2, A3, A4. So how to compute those 4 values? So in case of 4 PAM, where M is equal to 4, and the generalized equation is AI is equal to 2I minus 1 minus M into EG square root, where this EG is the energy of pulse. which is the rectangular pulse in our case. Right, so it is fixed. It will not depend on the value of I. The only thing which is depending on the value of I is this thing. So just start putting the values of M and I. So for M is equal to 4 and let's say I is equal to 1. So it will give A1, which is equal to 2 minus 1 minus 4 into EG square root. And we will have minus 3 times EG square root. Similarly, for I is equal to 2, we will have A2 is equal to, you can put on the values, it will be simply minus EG square root. And so on, for I is equal to 3, we will have A3 equal to EG square root. And for I is equal to 4, we will have A4 equal to 3 times EG. So these are four amplitudes that are responsible for the amplitudes of the points in the constellation diagram. So if I now draw the constellation diagram, it can be like this. We will have four points, point number 1, 2, 3 and 4. This is the origin. So the energies will be here. This was point for I is equal to 1, I is equal to 2, I is equal to 3 and I is equal to 4. So for I is equal to 1, we have computed it to be minus 3 times EG. Here it is minus EG, and here it is EG, and here it is 3 times EG. And because this is the case for M is equal to 4, so M is equal to 4 means if you convert it into number of bits per symbol, it will be K log to the base 2 M. And here it will come out to be 2. So we will have 2 bits per symbol. And those combinations will be 00, 01, 10 and 11. As we have already discussed in the previous lecture for baseband modulations. So the first symbol will be for 00. This one is 01. This is 10. Or assuming gray coding, we can have here 11 and 10. What is the motivation behind using the gray coding? Because as you should know that gray coding is a type of coding in which each adjacent symbol, there is only change in one bit. So here, as you can see, going from here to here, we have only one bit change, here only one bit change, and here only one bit change. So in between two adjacent symbols, there is a change of one bit only. Right. So the motivation behind using gray coding is to reduce the bit error rate performance, because if due to the presence of noise, if some way or the other there is a wrong detection, so instead of causing two or more bit errors, it will only generate one bit error. If we detect, let's say, 11 in place of 10, so there is only error in one bit. This is the reason why we use gray coding usually in digital communication systems. Right. So that was how to draw the constellation diagram of 4 PAM. Now, one of the main thing is in the selection of the modulation schemes is basically the computation of energy. Because whenever you are going to select appropriate modulation scheme for your system, there are two major concerns. Number one is bit error rate performance, that how this modulation scheme is performing in the presence of noise. And the second point is the total energy that you need to transmit the data by using this particular modulation scheme. So here we will be computing the average symbol energy for M array PAM. So the energy of the ith symbol, again, as already discussed in the previous lectures, whenever you are going to find out this energy of any symbol, that will be given by SI norm square, and that will be equal to this particular expression. If you just come from here to here, you simply take the square. If you take the square, you will end up by using this equation. And this is the energy of the ith symbol. But we have to compute the average symbol energy by averaging out the energy of all the symbols. So how we do that? We will use the general formulation. We will use the general formulation that was used to find out the average symbol energy, right? So here, let me show you how to compute this average symbol energy. The formula of average symbol energy, let me write it first. Average symbol energy and that energy was ES is equal to 1 over M summation I1 to capital M EI. Let's call it equation 1, where EI is just given by EG multiplied by 2I minus 1 minus M whole square. Now, using equation 1 now, using 1, we can write ES as 1 over M summation I1 to capital M, and this whole stuff EG into 2I minus, let me write it as M plus 1 whole square, so that it can be treated as A minus B whole square. This EG is constant. It will come outside over here, 1 over M, and we will apply summation. But before summation, let me open up this square. So it will become 4I square plus M plus 1 whole square minus 4I into M plus 1. Now, this EG and summation, we have got three terms now. We have I is equal to 1 over M. We take 4 outside. So 4 over M, I1 to capital M, I square, plus 1 over M, summation, I1 to capital M, M plus 1 whole square, minus 4 over M, summation, I1 to capital M, and I into M plus 1. Now, by using the formula of finite series, I can write here as 4 over M. This can be written as M into M plus 1 into 2M plus 1 divided by 6 by using the formula of series, plus it will become 1 over M into M times M plus 1 whole square minus 4 M plus 1 divided by M, and here summation I will be replaced by M into M plus 1 divided by 2. So now if you solve all this stuff, I'm just, because it is totally mathematics, so if you solve all these equations, it is very simple algebra, you will end up with an equation which is given by following expression, M square minus 1 divided by 3 multiplied by E subscript G. So this is the average symbol energy corresponding to MPAM, M-Ary PAM. Let's suppose if we are going to compute the average symbol energy for 4 PAM, so for 4 PAM, we have M is equal to 4, and for simplicity, let's assume EG is equal to 1. So in that case, we will have ES equals 4 square minus 1 divided by 3 multiplied by 1. So it is 16 minus 1, 15, and it will be 15 divided by 3. So that is the average symbol energy corresponding to 4 PAM. Whenever you are going to use 4 PAM, this will be the average symbol energy, assuming unit energy of the pulse shape. So that is how you compute the average symbol energy and average and the energy of ith symbol, and you draw the constellation diagram. Okay, so now having discussed the concept of binary ASK 4 PAM, this is a very similar diagram that we have already shown you. This red one is the carrier, this black one is the message signal, and then this blue one will be the pulse modulated signal. You see here the amplitude of the signal is being changed with respect to the amplitude of the carrier. Here it is similar to analog, because it is, here it is assumed that pulse shape is not rectangular, it is somewhat other shape, and due to this reason it is not purely a rectangular signal. Now at the end, what about the coherent detection of MPAM? As it is coherent detection, as I have already told you, that coherent detection is a process of demodulation or detection in which the receiver is using the information of carrier phase to perform demodulation. And this is point number one to keep in mind. And point number two is, this is one dimensional pulse modulation category, so we will be only requiring to have a single basis function to perform correlative detection, right? So if this is the received signal, we will only correlate it with psi 1 of t, because we have only got one basis function psi 1 of t. So they will be multiplied and passed through correlator, from which means integral from 0 to capital T, and it will generate the sampled output z1, and that z1 will pass through the detection stage. That z1 will be passed through detection stage, and this detection will be performing thresholding, and the number of thresholds will always be equal to m minus 1. So if we are going to use binding ASK, it means m is equal to 2. So we will be only requiring to have decision threshold, only one decision threshold. If we have, you're going to use MPAM, in particular 4PAM, so for m is equal to 4, we will only be requiring 3 thresholds, right? So after thresholding, we will be deciding the correct symbol. Let me show you the concept in the constellation diagram. First of all, let us go to the binding case. So in binding case, it is very much clear that we will only need one threshold, and that threshold may be like this. By using only one threshold, we will see that if the received symbol lies on the right side of this threshold, it will be detected as binary 1. And if the received symbol is located on the left side of this threshold in the amplitude scale, then it will be detected as binary 0, because this is the scale of the amplitude. Right. And similarly, so here you see, for m is equal to 2, we require m minus 1, which is one threshold. Similarly, for 4PAM, now this is the constellation diagram of 4PAM, in order to detect these symbols, we will need to have three thresholds. Number 1, so let us call it gamma 1, this is gamma 2, and this is gamma 3, right? So we have got three thresholds and four decision regions. So if any symbol comes here in this region, it will be detected as symbol 0. If some symbol lies in this decision region, it will be detected as 1. If any symbol comes over here, it will be detected as 3. If any symbol comes over here, it will be detected as 2. So we will have total of 3 thresholds, which is equal to m minus 1, and a total of 4 decision regions, right? So in this way, by performing the correlation, and why it is called coherent detection? That was an important point, because if you see, we are multiplying the received signal r of t with psi 1 of t, and that psi 1 of t was 2 over capital T cos omega ct plus phi, cos omega ct plus phi. So here you see, in order to have correct detection, you are using the argument of cosine. You are directly multiplying it with the basis function, which is basically the carrier having a particular frequency and a phase. So if you do not use, if there is a mismatch in the phase, then definitely the detection will be suffered. For example, if phase becomes equal to 90 degree, so in that case this cosine will be converted into sine, and that is called null effect in communication systems. So this is how the value of this phase is very critical, and this phase will be synchronized through PLL. So you can say that this psi 1 of t will be generated or will be coming from PLL in a synchronized fashion. If that synchronization fails, receiver may have problems in the detection process. So because it is directly using this carrier having the information of phase and frequency, that is why this particular detection is called coherent. And if you encounter any such kind of receiver which is directly multiplying the received signal with the basis functions, then in that case, that receiver is directly called coherent detection, right? So that is all about the discussion regarding the coherent detection of amplitude shift keying. In the next lectures, we will be continuing this concept of bandpass modulation, and we will be discussing the coherent detection of phase shift keying, as well as frequency shift keying and their different variants, and then followed by non-coherent detection. Thank you very much.